A quick, the agenda for the session today is a concept introduction to what is it actually all about. Understanding how does the solution from GRUNDFOS actually work in real life and on theoretical level. And then look into the system design leading to TOTEX. So the total expenditure that you're facing, capital and operational. Then we have a case story from Singapore that we'd like to share. And at the end, there will be a Q&A session. So let's just jump right into it. So distributed pumping is essentially looking into chilled water systems where we have thought of how do we optimize an already pretty optimized system and with a lot of components already in place. The key objective for GRUNDFOS is always to look for next generation technologies and so on, but also always staying true to our targets and goals to be an energy saving company. We will start off with a short movie.
There are many considerations when designing a cooling system for commercial buildings. To cool a building, existing chilled water systems generally use large centralized pumps and chillers in the mechanical room for pushing water around the chilled water loops. Regulating the flow due to the varying cooling needs is traditionally done using balancing and control valves, typically located close to the terminal units. But even efficient valves consume unnecessary energy due to pressure losses. Furthermore, a bypass line is typically used in the system to ensure sufficient flow to the chillers. Cooling systems with central pumps and valves have been designed in this way for decades. However, there are issues shared by existing cooling systems that lead to high energy consumption and less comfort in the building. One is commissioning and balancing, which is traditionally a time-consuming and tedious procedure, but essential for ensuring a system that operates to its highest potential. Inadequate commissioning leads to poorly balanced systems and excessive energy use. An incorrectly balanced system will result in having terminal units receiving more or less flow than necessary. This could also lead to low delta T. This is especially apparent at part load conditions and results in less comfort. But what if we design the system in a better way? Our solution is GRUNDFOS distributed pumping. By replacing valves with intelligent pumps, we use less energy while bringing more intelligence to your cooling system. A GRUNDFOS distributed pumping system uses the maintenance-free Magna 3 circulator and low-pressure non-return valves to prevent backflow. The distributed pumps ensure optimum pressure and flow at each terminal unit at all times. This also allows the centralized pumps managed by a new control logic to be significantly downsized because of the distributed pumps. This new design delivers perfect cooling comfort when and where it is needed within the building. With GRUNDFOS distributed pumping, you achieve the following benefits. An automatically balanced system at any load. Significant energy savings. Easy and fast commissioning. Let us help you design an efficient and reliable system with our knowledge and advanced tools. Cool your building more intelligently with less energy. GRUNDFOS distributed pumping.
So we will continue based on that brief introduction. So as the video mentioned, the typical air conditioning systems today consist of valves and balancing valves and pumps and chillers and cooling towers, etc. It's all pretty good. And as we know, as the video also stated, is that the valve is actually the throttling part. And by looking into possibilities of removing the throttling part, we will save pump energy. That's I think that's pretty obvious for everybody. So what does actually mean in a traditional context when we look into constant primary variable secondary systems, which is a global predominant design? I don't know Hong Kong, but in other areas of the world, this is what we see as the most dominant systems. And then we have a newer technology called variable primary systems or primary only systems, where it's energy optimization again with a single set of pumps. What we look to do is to, on a constant primary variable secondary, is to get rid of the secondary pumps and then introduce coil pumps. So we will introduce pumps per coil that essentially we could call them the secondary pumps that are also variable, but they are just distributed out to the loads. Looking at the variable primary system, what we want to do is to remove the bypass valve. So the bypass valve is typically there to ensure a minimum flow for chillers. And we want to control a free passage on the bypass. I'll come back to that later. And then at each load, again, we install the coil pumps that will drag the water. How that works and how that is designed will come much more into detail with that a little bit later. So when you look into the traditional systems, as mentioned also in the video and I mentioned just before, is that friction actually matters. So when you look into buildings with high rises or large campuses or shopping malls and so on, the number of units that actually acts to the friction loss, it really matters. And it's just to say some pictures here that illustrate that. But let's continue. So the conventional HVAC system today, it's like we sometimes say it's like driving your car with the accelerator all the way down and then controlling the speed with the brakes. We see that very often also in the older brownfield projects, where sometimes you even need to install pressure reducing valves at the chiller to keep the pump under control. And we see huge energy savings in situations like that. The distributed pumps then go in and replace these friction loss adders with intelligent pumps that then will distribute the water to the given load that's needed. So what we want to do, and I would say, and that's important also to remember, it's not for every kind of building in the whole world that this makes sense. So obviously, we need to do some due diligence. But in general, what we do is we minimize the building system pressure. And by that, by removing the friction adders, we maximum energy savings on your pump. When you then distribute pumps out to load, that means that balancing becomes not relevant any longer, you can say, because each of the pumps will react to its own. So you can say the pump is its own control area, and thereby it will be 100% demand driven on whatever set point you give the pump. When you have intelligent pumps, you don't need and not having to commission anymore, the commissioning becomes more an installation and configuration job. So it shows to be easier than before. So just to give you some headlines. So minimum pressure, what we've seen, and we have done quite a few projects around the world already, we see at least 50% savings when comparing to an conventional design. We see that we deliver the chilled water flow to the loads that we need at any given time. And we have some measurements of actually that the commissioning is faster and easier. Understanding how the solution works is the next topic. So in the chilled water system on the load side, we have different kind of loads. So we will take some examples today. So when you look at an air handling unit, for example, an air handling unit converts with a coil, chilled water with a fan, blowing air across the coil, and then delivers cold air into your occupancy areas. So what the pump does is that instead of being given a signal like a normal control valve of open or close or a percentage of opening, it will control based on a duct temperature. So the duct temperature will be located somewhere in the air duct connected to the air handler, and the pump will simply keep a constant temperature in that air duct. That also means that the pump will regulate the water flow accordingly to keep that airflow at a constant temperature. So that is essentially how it works in an air handling unit. So you should see this as a completely autonomous control loop where the pump will do all the control. When you then look into and understanding the coil characteristics and why actually makes a lot of sense, what we do is that when you then look into a coil energy transfer curve, this is taken from an S-ray HVAC systems and equipment document, you can see that actually the heat energy transfer in a coil is pretty flat on from 100 to the 80%. And that's where the pump actually can manipulate the flow and thereby give a less flow to the coil while still doing the same job. So which is proving a pretty good idea. Then when you look at the primary side of the system, so now we talked about the air handling unit, we'll come back a little bit more to different loads like fan coils. When we then look into the primary side, that one of the key issues here is for the system to be balanced. And what we mean by balanced is that the flow circulating on your primary side that consists of the chillers, the primary pumps, to the secondary side, which now consists of a number of distributed pumps on the coils. We try to keep the controllers that we do, they will try to keep at any given time a zero flow in a common decoupling pipe, or also known as a bypass. We do that by controlling temperatures. So if the temperatures are all equal to one another on this picture here, the flow will be in balance. What happens then is if you sort of see a switch in that four temperature method with controlling, the flow will run either way in that bypass because it's a free flowing bypass. This is necessary to have as well to keep chillers at a safety flow. So each chiller will have a minimum flow requirement. And if you don't keep that, that will trip the chiller out, obviously. So just going back to a quick summary of this, the key objective here is to keep the chiller minimum flow at any given time, but secondly, optimize the flow between the primary side and the secondary side. Looking into the pumps, the way they're controlled today, and I don't know if you recall in the video, he said that generally it's two big pumps already in the system. They are oversized and you need to, we can reduce that quite a bit. So this is a system curve and the pump curve at 100% speed. Typically these pumps are fixed speed. If you then look into the optimal duty point, that's when we go in and make a variable primary system. So I go for the blue curve down to the white optimal duty point. That's what I can achieve with adding a VFD and variable primary. But then if you look at a distributed pumping system, then you can see that we keep as constant system curve. And when we move on that system curve, you can see that particularly at part loads, when the flow is going down to your left, you can see the area of energy savings is just going much bigger than at 100% load. So I think also that's very obvious that At part loads, that's where you see valves, they need to throttle a lot more than at 100% flow, because then they're 100% open. So of course, that's where you can achieve the most energy savings. So when we put it all together, we'll give you an example of the hybrid system. So you always will see systems where you have large areas. It could be conference rooms, it could be kitchen areas, etc., where you have air handling units supplying bigger areas, but you will have fan coils for offices and so on. So in that situation, we cannot remove the valves because the fan coil units will be embedded with a valve already, and the valve will determine if the fan coil is on or off, basically. What we then do is that we look into a pump that controls a number of fan coils on a branch. By doing that, we use a control method called proportional pressure. And when you use proportional pressure, and this is just an example, is that the green lines here represent a number of fan coils. So you set your pump to control all the fan coils being on. And then as the fan coils will be taken out of operation or shut down, your pump will simply reduce its speed and flow according to the friction loss that it sees in this particular pipe. So I think this is a very standard way to control several loads at a proportional curve. When we talk about distributed pumping, we have a lot of questions on high rises. So what do you do then if your building is 450 meter tall? And we have a lot of experience from the Middle East with we call them extreme high rise. And I know in Hong Kong, you have quite a bit of extreme high rise as well. Typically what we do, and we are not, it's not only because of the pump, but also because of the PM class of the building. We see that often there will be heat exchangers installed at a given height that hydraulically separates. And that's also what we recommend to do, is to introduce hydraulic separation between different floors of the building to keep the PM class in check. And the way we control this is by having a pump that simply controls the supply temperature from one side, the source side of the heat exchanger, you can say, to the supply side. So you can see where it says 12 degree here, that's what it tries to keep. But of course, if you have a narrow delta T like in cooling, then you need to be very careful, because it is a loss you add to the system. We also see quite a bit of district cooling now to becoming more and more popular in especially the Middle East, in US and Europe. And we see a lot of what we call campus cooling. So it's a secluded area where you have a university, etc., with its own source. And there we simply have a variety of different ways to solve such an issue that actually applies to the topology the project may have at a given time. But still, it's the same philosophy. Get rid of your pressure reducing items that adds to throttling, and then install intelligent pumps with zero friction loss instead. So I think also we need to talk a little bit about pumps in more detail. So many years ago, I think back in 2012 or so, there were many articles also on distributed pumps, but at that time, the pumps and their ability to control were not at the same level as they are in 2021. Looking at the modern pump, it has a lot of cool feature that actually enables us to do this as we do today. So it's a high efficiency IE5 motors. It is very efficient compared to what you used to see. It has some energy optimized algorithms, such as a flow minute or minimum pressure that enables us to use it for an air handling unit, for example. Then it has, in GRUNDFOS, at least, we have embedded sensors in the pumps. So it's not always that we need to to buy a sensor and cable it connected to the pump. The pump internally will actually have both pressure and temperature sensors to make it very attractive on an installation job. When we look at the pump to your left, the Magna 3, that's where we say this is actually a maintenance-free pump, whereas the other pump is an inline pump with a shaft seal that requires maintenance. So we have different types depending on whatever application the application requires. Today, data is getting important, and we see a huge need for analytics on a cloud level or so on in buildings. And all the Grundfos products are always delivered as, you can call it a cloud edge or a computing edge or whatever word you want to use, that can control locally, but can be communicating back and forth so we can read and write registers via international approved protocols. So just to bring it to an end on the pump, so we have the high efficiency pumps. We remove the throttling valves. We can do flow and energy estimation already in the pump. And then you save on commissioning and you get guidance or assistance on commissionings where it's built into the software of these pumps. So instead of just being a piece of carbon steel, then now it's more like a computer, you could call it, a small controller. Just to give you a brief understanding of the flow limit. So the flow limit is actually one of the key features that enables us to use this pumps as coil pumps. So if you imagine a number of fan coils or one big air handling unit that requires a limit, and if you don't want to over pump it because then actually you waste energy, and this is what we want to counter, then this is what you do. You simply go in and you enter a flow limit per the pump, and the pump will never exceed that given point. So what makes a Magna 3 maintenance free? That is that there are no mechanical parts really that can wear and tear. So it's what's called a wet runner design, where you have a non-leakage design that makes it easy for us to assemble, but very, very reliable and maintenance free. And this is simply how it's working. It's also self-cooling, so that it will use the liquid to cool the motor itself. We see a need also from healthcare projects or military or data centers and so on, where resilience is important, and resilience will be more important than energy end of the day. In those systems, we have the possibility to do twin pumps. Twin pumps basically mean that you have one pump with two motors. So if one fails, you don't need to replace the pump itself, but the second motor will run when the first motor fails. So we see that in a few healthcare projects right now. Then we'll move to system design. So when you see as hydronic chilled water system, for us to be able to go in and replace the valves, we need a little bit more design and sizing that a valve does. So what we need to do is we need to look at the system like here identified. And then we need to look at each of the loads. We need to look at the pipe lengths, the bends, the fittings, etc. And when we've done that, we can basically go in and do the sizing. What we then do is that we size from the primary side to the furthest load. Then we look at okay, what is the friction loss at the different loops? And at those different loops, I need to determine my pump. So in here, the example is in loop one, I'll put a pump, and then I need to size this pump according to the friction loss in pipes and fittings from and components from that pump down to the plant room, to the chiller, to the primary pump, etc. So how does it look then if I compare the pressure profiles? And this is an example from a simulation. So if I have a primary only, and we compare with primary only because that is the most efficient chilled water system today. So if you look at the pressure you need 34.8 meters of head, and you have a 775 LPS on the primary side. Then if you compare that to your primary pumps in a distributed pumping, you have this, of course, the same flow because the flow demand will stay the same, but your head requirement will reduce dramatically. And why does it do that? That is, and maybe you remember talking about the four temperature sensor method and minimum chiller flow. This is what the system does in the decoupling line or the bypass, is that that's where we hydraulically separate the system. The primary system in a P-only system in a standard system will be sized and determined the head according to a two-third of the way down the building or at the end for the index loop. So that's where we change that completely. As you can see here also, it looks very funny on the riser one or riser two, etc. And that's actually the nature of distributed pumping. Instead of pushing water out in the system as you do in the P-only example, we drag water from where the pump is located, and thereby the demand driven and all that I explained earlier. But this also here very clearly shows that the pump will drag the water from the decoupling line. It will overcome the friction loss that you have in the load. And then you can see that if the pump would not be running, the return line pressure is actually higher than your supply pressure, because now you don't push water out all the way to the end of the building, but now you rather drag it. So if there's no need to drag, then of course the return line pressure will be higher. So that's why it's very, very important for our system to have non-return valves so you don't risk a backflow in the system. So looking a little bit on this simulation, and it's done in a program called Flowmaster, and this just shows the differences between 100% load, part load, and so on. So if you look at the 100%, you can see that the pressure curves are just like I visualized before. But the interesting part is when you go to part loads, and that's where you can see that actually your control valve and balancing valve, you can see where they need to work. So on your left side, you can see the pumping power is 2.28 kilowatt in this example, and your throttling 11.94 meters. If you then go to the other side, at 50% load, then you can see that the pumps actually drag a lot less water. And you can see that your pumping power in this case is of course the sum of coil pumps plus the primary pump. You can see that the total here is 1.16 kilowatt. So a dramatic reduction of what it used to be with a standard system, a conventional system, and now to a distributed pumping system. So this is where we see the biggest benefit is when you go, as mentioned before, when you go from 100% to part load. And I think a lot of you will also agree that most buildings are oversized and are not running at 100% load as designed. They're running at somewhere between 25 and 60% most of the time. So that's where we see a huge benefit with a system like distributed pumping. So just to round it off, let's do a visual summary of what we just went through. So what does the distributed pumping do? Looking at your pumps on the plant room side, it will overcome, of course, the pipe pressure loss. It will have a pretty big pressure loss through the component. In this case, it's the chiller. Then it will have loss in the pipe. So this is the pressure I need to add, and then it will of course return to the pump again. So this is a decoupling, and if you can see the very tiny orange pipe, this is my decoupling line or bypass. So the distributed pumps that are located in the loops, when you look at the pipe going from the bypass to that particular first load, you can see the pipe head loss, bends and fittings will be like this. The pump then need to overcome the friction loss of that pipe plus whatever fittings it sees on the branch towards the air handling unit in this case. Then it will see the head loss through the air handling unit, and then the water will go back. And then again, that's what it will do to the next and next and next. And you could have an endless line of pumps or distributor pumps that goes like this on one riser. Of course, the type of pump we will use depends on the system flow you need, or the air handling unit flow or component flow you need. And of course, also the head loss that each of the particular pumps see. Good. Then let's talk a little bit about the capital investment side of it. So we have done some pretty significant comparisons. And when we do this comparison of a 25 floor building, we can see these are the savings we achieve with a primary only system versus a distributed pumping system. So as I mentioned before, when you go into the part loads, that's where you see the numbers are, for some consultants, almost too good to be true on a pump system. So in this comparison, if you look at the 24 hour a day, 270 working days for 5 years, this is the way we see the load profile distribute. So if you compare that for a 5 year period, we see a 63% energy reduction on chilled water, pumping energy. So let's just go back to that one. So that is what we see being achievable. But also when you talk about investment, you need to take into consideration, okay, control and balancing valves have been in the market for quite some time. You have a PICV valves that are still also in the market for quite some time, but relative new. And then GRUNDFOS comes with a distributed pumping that is completely new. So what we see is that they are, depending on how you calculate, but the way we look at it is also taking into consideration the balancing and all that. So when you look at the material cost, we see that comparable, the PICV valves will have a higher price index. This is not dollars or Danish kroner or whatever. It is basically an index. So we see that the PICV valves will have a higher price index than the pumps. And we see, depending on size, I would also say that the pumps are on par with the control balancing valve package. When you then look at installation cost, we see that the PICV valves are actually the most favorable when installing, and the pumps will be the most expensive because you need power, you need other stuff as well on that actual installation site. And then we see the PICV valves and the pumps being the most favorable because none of them require real balancing and all that. So we see that in total, the distributed pump are on par with the valve. I will not say one is better than the other, but I will just say it's not the capex that should determine this is expensive or cheap. When you then look at energy savings, we put in 200 here, an index for distributed pumping, because regardless if it's a PICV valve or control and balancing valve, they need to throttle the water. So whatever you put into the water in the basement, you need to reduce that pressure for the given branch that you're going into. With a distributed pumping, you will drag the water, so thereby there will be no throttling at all. So putting just in a table here is just when we look at the numbers, this is how it looks on the commissioning side. And it's based on ASHRAE recommendations for balancing and our experience in the field. If building owners or facility management teams or new builds, they follow the ASHRAE guidelines for balancing and all that, we really don't know. So this is taken out of that standard or recommendation. So now we should talk a little bit about the case story. So of course, a company like GRUNDFOS, we have to have our solution tested and verified. And we have actually done a case story, as I will show you, but also we have already released this in the field. So looking at this project we did some time ago in Singapore, it's called Ngee Ann Polytechnic. And what's remarkable about this building, block 22, is that it's approximately 6,000 square meters of cooling. It has the teaching, exam, and break time. And then it already has a Green Mark Platinum rating for Singapore, which is the highest you can get. So you could ask yourself, how can a distributed pumping make this better? So looking into the pumps we have installed, the 15 Magna pumps installed, they look like this. We have the primary pumps installed that went from 5.5 kW to 1.5 kW. And then when we look at the 3-week monitoring period, we went from a energy consumption of 9.4 kW to a 54% reduction to 4.3. And as you all know, the Singapore is a tropical climate, so it's not like it's gonna change a lot, the climate outside. But of course, the three patterns will change. So when you then look at delta T, also that's something we measured, but we're not studying too much about it though, is that with a distributed pumping, due to the fact that you have better heat energy transfer, again, due to the demand-driven nature of the system, then you are closer to your design delta T than you were before. So that's pretty good. So your design delta T was 5.5. You achieved with a valve-based system, Green Mark Platinum, the 5.3, and now we actually increase that with 28%, which is very extraordinary. So coming to an end, so how do you get projects started? As I hope is clear, is that we need a certain kind of design. So we need to know building layout, we need to know load schedules and so on for a particular project. Then we can go in and do a quick assessment to give you an idea. Okay, what kind of savings are we looking at? Is it in the 50 or is it the 60%? And then if you want to do a real design, then we have to get project piping schematics and detailed HVAC equipment information. And I know for some brownfield projects, it's actually difficult to achieve those, or if you have it, you often don't know if the particular building looks like this anymore because the drawings are maybe 30 years old. So that makes it very challenging. But for new build, of course, this is the easiest way to go. We always submit an energy savings report and a comparison. So we will do that based on a comparison tool. And we will add that to whatever information you get out of that check. How do you get started then? So we have local representatives in GRUNDFOS pretty much all over the world. So please reach out to your local GRUNDFOS company and they can get you started on this journey. Thank you. Goodbye.